tears that bids our sorrow cease. His music kindly sinners ears, his life from health and peace. He breaks the power of cancer sin, sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean, his blood availed for me. Till his voice new like the dead receive, the mournful broken hearts rejoice, the humble poor believe. Glory to God and praise and love, he ever, ever again. Saints below and saints above, the church and earth and heaven.
Grace Church, and welcome this morning as we're coming together again to worship after the celebration of Easter. Let's draw our hearts to the greatness of God this morning and of our Savior, the King. In 1 Chronicles chapter 16, starting in verse 23, it says, "Sing to the Lord, all the earth, tell of his salvation from day to day, declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples, for great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, and he is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the peoples are worthless idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him, strength and joy are in his place. So ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come before him. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. Tremble before him, all the earth. Yes, the world is established. It shall never be moved. Let the heavens be glad. Let the earth rejoice. And let them say among the nations, the Lord reigns." Please stand and join us this morning as we sing of his greatness, because our King reigns.
In the splendor rejoice, he wraps himself in night, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. And how good, how great
is our God.
Sing with me, how great.
Thank you.
is our God.
Sing it out.
He's the name above all names. Oh, he is worthy of all praise. And my heart is singing all praise. He's our God.
Praise the Lord for his greatness. We also need to remember our own humility, that we are sinners in need of a Savior. So let us acknowledge this and give thanks that through his grace and mercy we can be cleansed. Please join with me in confession this morning. Merciful God, you pardon all who truly repent and turn to you. We humbly confess our sins and ask your mercy. We have not loved you with a pure heart, nor have we loved our neighbor as ourselves. We have not done justice, loved kindness, or walked humbly with you, our God. Have mercy on us, O God, in your loving kindness, in your great compassion, cleanse us from our sin. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within us. Do not cast us from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from us. Restore to us the joy of your salvation and sustain us with your bountiful Spirit. Amen.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of man and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, bowing to the Father's will, he took the crown of thorns.
Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Alleluia, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven, God's own Son, to purchase and redeem,
reconcile the very
ones who nailed him to the tree. How that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, alleluia, praise and
precious blood that my Jesus spilled. The curse of sin has no hold on me, 'cause when the sun sets free, oh, it's free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled.
thee. Amen. Our God is worthy, is he not, to receive glory and honor and power. Let us continue to praise him that he might fill us and help us to live our lives for him. He is worthy. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. He's the name above all names. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say. He's worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you.
Show me who you are and feel.
you would build our lives, Lord, to center and to focus on you, Lord, that we might glorify you through all that we do, Lord, that you would be our firm foundation. We thank you for the opportunity we have to come before you and to worship together, Lord. We pray that you would be with Pastor Austin as he brings the message this morning, Lord, that you would reach out to this congregation, that you would fill our hearts, Lord, that you would make yourself known, and that you would send us forth, Lord, to shine your glory. We ask all these things in your precious and holy name. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning. My name's Austin. I'm the lead pastor here at Grace, and we're very glad to be worshiping with you this morning. If you're joining us online, we're glad to worship with you as well. If you're new here, we have some gifts at the back, white bags at the Welcome Center. Please take one of those with you, and there's a Connect card if you would like to share some information with us, or if you would like to get on our weekly emails, you can fill out one of those Connect cards and drop it into the blessing box, or you can do that online. We are not passing around the offering plate, but if the Lord compels you to give of your tithes and offerings, you can put that in the blessing box, or you can also do that online. I do want to draw your attention to a couple things that we have going on in the Grace family. We have a Discover Grace on Sunday, April 18th, right after the service. For anyone who is considering church membership, or maybe you attended a Taste of Grace and you just want to go a little bit deeper into the structure, vision, and mission of our church, you can sign up for that. It's again at the Welcome Center. You would need to sign up for that. We'll be doing Subway sandwiches. So if you plan to come, please fill out the form in the back and put your Subway order form in the blessing box. Also, we are hosting the blood drive on Wednesday, April 21st, 1 through 6 p.m. It's organized by the National Honor Society at Bigfoot High School in partnership with the American Red Cross. And it'll be here in the Fellowship Hall. And if you would like to sign up to give blood on that date, you can find the information for that in your bulletin. So we encourage you to be a part of that as we host and also as we give as well. We do not have a children's church service, but we do get to participate in what our children are learning through the Gospel Project content. And I love it. It's Christ in all of Scripture, grace for all of life. And we are learning Scripture together. If you want to know more about the Gospel Project, you can visit the bulletin board in the back. If you are regularly coming and your kids don't have an assigned bag, there is a form to fill out and put that in the blessing box as well if you would like to get your own family bag. And so we're learning a new Scripture passage today, and we will also hear a Bible story as well, and then Jeff DeVore will lead us in a time of prayer.
Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Teaching them to observe everything I have commanded.
King Herod Agrippa was persecuting believers in the church. He killed James, one of Jesus' disciples. When the king saw how happy this made the Jews, he arrested Peter too. The king put Peter in prison and assigned groups of soldiers to keep guard. While Peter was in prison, other believers in the church prayed and asked God to help him.
The king planned for Peter to be killed. The night before his execution, Peter was sleeping between two soldiers. He was tied up with chains, and other soldiers stood guard at the gate of the prison. All of a sudden, an angel of the Lord appeared, and a bright light shone in Peter's prison cell. The angel struck Peter on the side and woke him up. "Quick, get up," the angel said. The chains fell off of Peter's wrists. The angel told Peter to get dressed, so Peter put on his sandals and his cloak. Then he followed the angel. Peter wasn't sure what was happening. He thought he was seeing a vision.
The angel led Peter out of the prison, past the guards, through the gate, and onto the streets. Then the angel left. When Peter looked around, he realized the Lord had rescued him from prison and from certain death. Peter hurried to the house of Mary, the mother of John Mark. Believers had gathered there to pray. When Peter knocked at the door, a servant named Rhoda answered. She heard Peter's voice, and she was so happy. She rushed back inside. "Peter is here. He is at the door," she announced.
But the others didn't believe her. "You're crazy," they said. But Peter kept knocking, and when they opened the door, they could hardly believe it. Peter motioned to them to be quiet, and he told them how the Lord had rescued him from prison. "Tell James and the other brothers about this," Peter said. Then he left. When the sun came up, the soldiers at the prison couldn't figure out what happened to Peter, and the king punished the soldiers because Peter had escaped.
God answered the people's prayers for Peter. God had a plan for Peter and the church, and he rescued Peter from his enemies. Peter knew he would face death because he believed in Jesus, but he kept going so he could share the good news of the gospel.
All right, well, good morning, Grace Church. Will you please bow in prayer with me? Dear God, our sovereign Lord and Father in heaven, we come before you now humbly asking that you hear our prayers. We recognize that you are the eternal living being, the giver of life, the one true God in all the universe. Indeed, you are the creator and sustainer of the universe, just as you created and sustain each of us. And just as the patriarch Jacob, at the end of his earthly days when he blessed his children, acknowledged that the Lord God had been his lifelong shepherd, the one who had watched over him, and the one who had tenderly cared for him and protected him from harm all the days of his life, so we too want to acknowledge that it is the very same with us, that it is you, the Lord God Almighty, who has protected and blessed us throughout our lives, whether we've been aware of it at the time or not. And we now ask you, Lord, for your continued protection and blessing in our lives. We need it so very, very much. And we will give you all the praise and honor and glory, for you alone are worthy. We confess that we have sinned against you and fallen short of the standards you require of us countless times. In our hearts, we want to love and serve you faithfully, yet our flesh is so very weak, and we often stumble. Please forgive us for our failures and our shortcomings, and by your immeasurable mercy and grace, instill in us the faith we need to love our fellow man, to serve you better, and to please you, because we know from your perfect word that without faith it is impossible to please you. Grant us that faith, Lord, and teach us to strive to do your will and not simply our own. We pray now for this local body of believers, for our specific personal needs and concerns that we raise up to you at this time from our hearts. One prayer request in particular that we have is for a nephew of Katie Morris and Mike Lazzaroni, His name is Colton Lazzaroni. He's only 6 years old, but he's on a heart transplant list. He's had a stroke already, and he's at Children's Hospital in Milwaukee in stable condition, but he needs our prayer. Lord, meet that need. And Lord, there are many others in our congregation that have needs that you know of, and only you can meet those needs. Please, Lord, we ask, hear us and answer our prayers. We also want to pray for believers throughout the world in the Universal Church, many of whom come under life-threatening persecution daily. We don't know how we would bear up under such pressure, but we ask that you protect them and supply all their needs as only you are able. There's much darkness and evil in our world today, Lord, and we ask that you would cause the light of truth to shine on that evil, expose it, and defeat it. Help each of us to internalize your truth and to teach it to our children, that each one might grow to become a mighty servant of yours. Now be with Pastor Austin as he brings that truth to us from your word and prepare us, help us, that we might have our hearts and minds ready to hear it and receive it on fertile ground. We ask all of this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, friends, we are in a series working through the second half of Genesis, a series that we've called God's Faithfulness Amidst Man's Failures. This morning, we're going to be in Genesis 32, verses 1 through 21. If you're using one of the Bibles in the seat in front of you, that's going to be on page 27. So it's Genesis 32, 1 through 21. The good news of God's grace is not just in the New Testament. It's throughout the whole Bible, and it is certainly in the book of Genesis. It's God's steadfast love that compels him to be faithful to his promises, not our steadfast obedience. And so as we read from Genesis 32, we're reading Moses' words to the Israelites, but the inspired words of God to us this morning. So let's read from Genesis 32, starting in verse 1 and reading through to verse 21. Jacob went on his way, and the angels of God met him. And when Jacob saw them, he said, "This is God's camp." So he called the name of that place Mahanaim. And Jacob sent messengers before him to Esau, his brother, in the land of Seir, the country of Edom, instructing them, "Thus you shall say to my lord Esau, thus says your servant Jacob, I have sojourned with Laban and stayed until now. I have oxen, donkeys, flocks, male servants, and female servants. I have sent to tell my lord in order that I may find favor in your sight." And the messengers returned to Jacob saying, "We came to your brother Esau, and he is coming to meet you, and there are 400 men with him." Then Jacob was greatly afraid and distressed. He divided the people who were with him and the flocks and the herds and the camels into two camps, thinking if Esau comes to the one camp and attacks it, then the camp that is left will escape. And Jacob said, "O God of my father Abraham and God of my father Isaac, O Lord who said to me, 'Return to your country and to your kindred that I may do you good,' I am not worthy of the least of all the deeds of steadfast love and all the faithfulness that you have shown to your servant. For with only my staff I crossed the Jordan, and now I've become two camps. Please deliver me from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him that he may come and attack me, the mothers with the children. But you said, 'I will surely do you good and make your offspring as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude.' So he stayed there that night, And from what he had with him, he took a present for his brother Esau, 200 female goats and 20 male goats, 200 ewes and 20 rams, 30 milking camels and their calves, 40 cows and 10 bulls, 20 female donkeys and 10 male donkeys. These he handed over to his servants, every drove by itself, and said to his servants, "Pass on ahead of me and put a space between drove and drove." He instructed the first, "When Esau, my brother, meets you and asks you, 'To whom do you belong? Where are you going? And whose are these ahead of you?' Then you shall say, 'They belong to your servant Jacob. They are a present sent to my lord Esau. And moreover, he is behind us.'" He likewise instructed the second and the third, "And all who follow the droves, you shall say the same thing to Esau when you find him. And you shall say, 'Moreover, your servant Jacob is behind us.' For he thought, 'I may appease him with the present that goes ahead of me, and afterwards I shall see his face. Perhaps he will accept me.' So the present passed on ahead of him, and he himself stayed that night in the camp." These are God's words. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are not what we ought to be. Help us this morning to become that. We know not what we should know. Help us to know that. We don't love you as we should. Help us to love you. And through the Holy Spirit and through your grace, change us, transform us, renew our view of your love, and help us to love you as well. Through the power of your word, through the Holy Spirit, we pray these things. In Jesus' name, amen. An American pastor and author, James H. Brooks, he wrote about visiting a friend, and when he went into the house, he heard the sound of bird chirping, but it wasn't like the ordinary sound of a bird chirping. It actually had a melody to it, almost like a song. And his friend's wife explained that the bird had been taught to sing this song. A teacher would repeat the notes over and again until the bird was able to mimic the sounds. But the wife went on to say that this song can only be taught at night when it's dark and the bird's attention cannot be diverted but completely focused on the teacher. You might have picked up on this, but in the passage for this week and next week, night or darkness is a repeated theme. Some of the references tonight are literal, but in a figurative way, this whole section of Scripture is about Jacob being led through darkness into God's promise. And not only that, but through the darkness of challenges and difficulties, Jacob's attention is going to be directed towards his teacher. And God is going to teach Jacob to sing a song of faithfulness, dependency, trust and humility, and he's going to learn to sing that song in the dark. God uses difficulties in our lives to teach us to sing faithfulness, to learn faithfulness, and he is going to teach that to Jacob. We're going to break up this passage into three parts: the promise, the prayerful plan, and the present. You can follow along in your notes, and there's actually going to be some passages of Scripture that I'll refer to, so you might want to have your bulletin out. And as we do this, we're going to discover how God teaches us to sing and learn faithfulness in the dark. All right, so let's start with the promise, looking primarily at verses 1 through 5. Now, a little bit of a background here. 20 years earlier, in fear for his life, Jacob fled from Esau, who wanted to kill him, and fled from his homeland. And while fleeing from Esau, God appeared to Jacob. And he appeared to Jacob at night in a dream at a place that Jacob would call Bethel. And in this vision, a stairway came down from heaven and angels descended and ascended from this stairway. And God spoke to Jacob, spoke promises to Jacob. And back those 20 years ago, recorded in Genesis 28, God said this, Behold, I am with you, and I will keep you wherever you go, and I will bring you back to this land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. As Jacob fled the land, God promised to be with him. Now in chapter 32, where we're at today, Jacob is returning to the land. But in order to return to the land, Jacob must pass through Esau. And with this excitement of coming back home, there's a dark cloud on the horizon. But the God who was with Jacob when he fled Esau is with Jacob when he faces Esau as well. We're told in verse 1, as Jacob went on his way, the angels of God met him. And most likely in parallel to this vision at Bethel 20 years earlier, this was a vision of angels that he saw at night. And seeing these angels, Jacob declared in verse 2, he said, "This is God's camp." Now, you might remember back in Genesis 28 when he had that vision of the angels at Bethel. What did he say about that place? He said, "This is none other than God's house." Back 20 years ago when he had this vision of God, Jacob just assumed, "I must have stumbled upon God's residence." However, in his second vision, Jacob realizes that God's not stationary. God is on the move. His angels are like a military encampment. Wherever Jacob goes, they go with him. In the darkness of fleeing Esau, God is there. In the darkness of facing Esau, God is there. And God is fulfilling his promises at Bethel to be with him. Now, if you've been with us for a while, you know that Jacob hasn't exactly lived in a faithful way towards the God who has been with him. He hasn't exactly been exemplary, has he? But the presence of God has not been dependent upon Jacob's religious performance. It's been dependent upon God's promise. And even when Jacob hasn't acknowledged the presence of God, and even as Jacob hasn't lived in tune with the presence of God, God has never broke his promise. He has always been with Jacob. And by his grace and his long-suffering faithfulness, God is teaching Jacob to be aware of that presence and to be faithful to the God who is present with him. And we sang this morning in that Bible passage a promise that has been given to us. I will be with you to the very end of the age. As long as you are alive, until he calls you home or he returns, Jesus is with you in all kinds of darkness. And even when you can't see him, he is there and strengthening you and teaching you to be aware of his presence and to live in faithfulness to his presence. Now, God promised to be with Jacob, and in this vision of the angels encamped around him, it's the presence of God that empowers Jacob to be courageous and also humble in facing this darkness ahead and facing Esau. And the way that the passage is written, right after seeing this encampment of angels, Jacob sends messengers to Esau. God sends angels to protect Jacob. Jacob sends messengers to seek peace with Esau. And this message that Jacob sends is really humble, which is unusual for Jacob. Ever since he was born, he was seeking his own first place, his own priority, even grabbing at the heels of his brother while they were being born. He put himself first his whole life. But he's learning humility. In this message, in verse 4, he calls Esau his master, and he calls himself Esau's servant. And he goes on in this message, in verse 5, you'll note that he sends an inventory of all of his possessions. And now we might look at that and think, well, gosh, that's awful boastful. Why is he sending that? But he's not actually bragging about what he has. He's actually seeking Esau's favor. We have to remember that Jacob is the heir to their father's estate. And by sending this inventory, Jacob is saying, I don't have material needs. And while I'm the heir to our father's estate, I am not coming for your possessions. I'm coming for peace. I'm coming to have favor with you. You see, God had been with Jacob, and over these 20 years of struggling with Laban, God had also blessed Jacob, but not just blessed him so that he might have material need, but to teach him humility and dependency on God. You know, Jacob used to be a trickster, always trying to find ways to connive a deal. But now he's becoming a man of humility and also a man who seeks reconciliation. Your connect question for this week, which is in your bulletin, is going to have you consider your own experience. How is God's grace transforming you? How is his presence producing humility in you, and also a desire to seek out reconciliation with others? And if it's not, why is that? Because that's how God works, through his grace and his presence, transforms us, not just with the blessings of material, but transformation in our character. Okay, so the promise, and now the prayerful plan. Right after experiencing this incredible vision of these angels encamped around him, and after being encouraged by the presence of these angels to face the darkness of Esau, a dark cloud shows up on the horizon. The messengers return, and they say, Esau's coming with 400 men with him. Now, the way that the Hebrew is written, we're supposed to like envision like a horde of warriors headed towards Jacob, kind of like in a movie where you see like the Mongol warriors coming, but the video only shows the hooves of the horses hitting the ground. That's what we're supposed to picture. That's what's happening. And there's only one way to interpret it. Esau's military camp is on its way, and it is coming quickly. You know, earlier God had granted Jacob with a reassuring vision, a vision that actually boosted his courage, helped him grow in his faith. But God also allows a threat to that faith. But here's the thing, like God will show you how to grow through his grace, but he will also show you how to grow in challenges. But his intentions are always to grow us, to teach us to sing a song of faithfulness if we're willing to learn and divert our attention to him, even in the midst of the darkness. And Jacob is learning to grow in his faithfulness towards God, even when his faith is tested. You see, Jacob is terrified by the news, but he's not paralyzed by the news. After hearing this news, he jumps into a plan of action. Now, trusting God and being faithful to God doesn't mean, you know, passively sitting on our hands. And it was actually passivity in Jacob's family that had caused so much problems. You have the passivity of Abraham with Hagar. You have the passivity of Isaac with Abimelech. And you also have the passivity with Jacob when Rachel and Leah were feuding. Passivity had caused chaos. We are not called to live passively. And Jacob is no longer the passive patriarch. In the face of this dark trial, he moves forward with a plan of action to protect his family. But this plan of action is not self-dependency. It's actually independency of God's protection. Like earlier in verse, verse 2. In verse 2, after seeing this encampment of angels, Jacob named the place Mahanaim. And this Hebrew word, it means two camps. So, Esau's coming. He can't see the angels anymore. But he knows that God has sent two camps of angels to protect him. And so he plans in light of God's presence. His plan is both practical and it's also providential. It's practical in the sense of if Esau attacks this camp, this one can escape. But it's also providential in the sense that God has sent an angel of a camp of angels to protect us. Two of them, Mahanaim, were secured. Let's move forward. And so he's planning in conjunction with God's presence, which is a new thing for Jacob. In verses 7 through 8, he plans. And in verses 9 through 12, he prays. And this prayer is probably the most notable example of Jacob learning to sing faithfulness while in a dark situation. And this prayer in Genesis 32, this becomes even more evident when we compare this prayer to the past prayer in Genesis 28. See, there's two things that bookend Jacob's fleeing from Esau and facing Esau. One is the presence of God, and the other thing is two prayers. Prayers that are very different and show how God has been transforming Jacob through these 20 years of trials that he has faced. So what we're going to do this morning, and you can see this in your bulletin, is I'm actually going to reread the prayer from Genesis 28 and reread the prayer from Genesis 32, and then we're going to compare them and see how Jacob has been changed, and also kind of take a moment to look in the mirror and see how we might need our prayer life to be changed as well. And again, as a backdrop, in Genesis 28, Jacob is fleeing Esau. He's tricked Esau out of his birthright, and Esau is like, I'm going to kill that guy. And so Jacob gets out of there, and he's headed up north to his uncle Laban. And as he is fleeing just by himself, God appears to him in a vision, and angels are ascending and descending onto the ground. And Jacob speaks a promise of blessing and a promise to be with him. It's an amazing moment. And here's Jacob's response. Genesis 28, verses 20 through 22. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, if God will be with me and will keep me in this way that I go and will give me bread to eat and clothing to wear so that I come again to my father's house in peace, then the Lord shall be my God. And this stone which I have set up for a pillar shall be God's house. And of all that you give me, I will give a full tenth to you. So that's the prayer in Genesis 28. Now let's go on to the prayer in Genesis 32, 20 years after this. In verse 9, Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham and God of my father Isaac, O Lord, who said to me, return to your country and to your kindred that I may do you good. I'm not worthy of the least of all the deeds of steadfast love and all the faithfulness that you have shown to your servant. For with only my staff I crossed this Jordan, and now I have become two camps. Please deliver me from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him that he may come and attack me, the mothers with the children. But you said, I will surely do you good and make your offspring as of the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for multitude. Okay, so two prayers, very different. How are they different? Well, let's consider this. His first prayer, it's kind of like a prayer of formality. It's not even a prayer, it's more of a vow. Even after God has powerfully showed himself and made these incredible promises to Jacob, Jacob just speaks to the wind, a vow, a commitment that doesn't even acknowledge the nearness and the relationship that God has moved towards Jacob with. So his first prayer is a prayer of formality. His second prayer is a prayer of familiarity. Jacob doesn't just speak to the wind. He calls out, oh God, God of my heritage, of my fathers, but God who's also spoken to me, my God. You've made yourself known to me through your promises. His first prayer, it was a prayer of condition. If you do this, then I will do that. His second prayer was a prayer of admission. The first thing that Jacob admits in this prayer is, God is God. The second thing that Jacob admits is, I am not. If you look at verse 10, he says, I am unworthy. Literally, I am small. I am insignificant compared to your greatness, your glory, but most importantly, your graciousness. I don't deserve all the things that you've done for me. You've done it by faith. You've been faithful to me by grace. His first prayer was a prayer for evidence. Prove to me that you are God, and then you can be my God. His second prayer, however, was a prayer for deliverance and dependence. Please deliver me. I'm afraid. Esau's coming. I don't know where to turn. Don't deliver me to prove that you're God, but because you are God. And because of the promises that you have made. His first prayer ends with a payment to God. You know, Jacob used to be a wheeler and dealer, always trying to connive some sort of bargain. And even in this first prayer back in Genesis 28, he's trying to do a deal with God. You know, if you do all these things, I'll build you a nice house here at Bethel. And I'll give you 10% of everything that you give me. But he's beginning to realize that God doesn't need his deals. His first prayer was a prayer of payment. His second prayer was a prayer understanding provision. Provision from God. I came with a stick. I'm leaving with two camps. You have been good to me. You have been gracious to me. Continue to be good to me. I'm just your servant. Your contemplation question for this week will ask you to consider these two prayers. And then I've included some of this within the notes. When you consider the nature of your own prayer, do you resonate with one of those? Do you resonate more with Genesis 28 or Genesis 32? And how might God be calling you into a more faithful prayer life, changing you so that you can model after Jacob's prayer in Genesis 32? Okay, so the promise, the prayerful plan, and now the present. In verses 13 through 19, what Jacob does is he divides up a large sum of some of the best possessions that he has, and he gives them to his servants, and he says, I want you to deliver these to Esau in sequence as gifts. Now, the idea is this. As Esau is coming closer and closer, more of these gifts will be going out to him and being received, up to the point where Esau is going to eventually just be surrounded by all of these gifts from Jacob. And in verse 20, Jacob explains why he's doing this. He says, I may appease him with the present that goes ahead of me. And afterwards, I shall see his face. Perhaps, he will accept me. All right, there's three words in verse 20 that are very important. The word accept, the word present, and the word appease. These are like cultic words. They're going to be later used by the Israelites in their sacrificial system at the temple. And so let's just go through these. The first one, accept. Accept is the Hebrew word that's commonly used for forgiveness or the removal of guilt. So for Jacob to be accepted by Esau, that means forgiven by Esau. David, the psalmist, uses this word in Psalm 32. Blessed is the one whose transgression is forgiven. Jacob understands that he's wronged Esau. He needs acceptance. He needs forgiveness. He needs his guilt to be overlooked. And he's seeking to have that guilt overlooked by the next word, present. The word present is the Hebrew word commonly used for the word offering. Or sacrifice. These gifts are being given in order to cover up a wrong, to seek forgiveness through these gifts that Jacob is giving. The final word, appease, this is a Hebrew word that you actually may have heard before. It's Kippur, as in Yom Kippur, or Day of Atonement. To appease someone is to pacify their wrath against you, or to make atonement to someone that you have offended. And so Jacob is seeking to appease Esau's wrath by offering a sacrifice or a gift in order to have forgiveness and reconciliation. Now, the Bible is very clear. We have all wronged God. Everyone in the Bible calls it sin. Everyone has sinned against God and rightfully deserves God's wrath. That's the situation that we are in. And to add on to this problem, we don't have enough offerings or enough presents or enough gifts to give God in order to be reconciled back to God and to find favor with Him, to appease His wrath. That's the bad news. But there is good news. And the good news is this: because we cannot appease God on our own, God makes the offering of appeasement on our behalf. It's a gift way more lavish than Jacob's possessions, way more lavish than all the possessions in the whole wide world. God gives His Son. Romans 5, 8 through 9 says this: but God shows His love for us, and that while we were still sinners, basically still in opposition to God, not even like Jacob, we haven't even come to our senses yet, but even while we were still in opposition to Him, Christ died for us. There's the offering of appeasement. And the verse goes on to say this: since therefore we have been justified by His blood, covered, made acceptable, declared innocent, forgiven. Now being justified by His blood, much more shall we be saved by Him from the wrath of God. Appeasement for our wrongs against the holy God. You see, the ferocity of God's just wrath falls on Christ, so the lavishness of God's love and favor can fall on us, fall on all who have faith in Christ. You see, Jacob sends gifts to someone he has wronged. God sends His Son for those who have wronged Him. And because it's God who makes the offering, we can be confident in its effectiveness. You see, in verse 20, when Jacob explains these gifts of appeasement to Esau, the best he can do is a perhaps. Maybe he'll accept me. Perhaps these will appease his wrath. If you're trusting in what you can offer God, the best you can have is a perhaps kind of situation. That's the best. But there's no perhaps with God's gift of atonement. There is no maybe as to whether or not you will be accepted by God through the blood of Christ. Romans 8:1 says this: there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation for those who are in Christ. Absolutely none. But the thing is, that also means there is no reconciliation outside of Christ. Jacob's about to face Esau, and he doesn't know what the circumstance is going to be. All of us will eventually face God. That's inevitable. The real question is this: when you face Him, will you face Him as friend, or will you face Him as foe? And what gives you certainty over your standing before him? Is it what you plan to bring or offer? Perhaps. Or are you trusting in the gift that he has offered? You can't achieve favor with God. You can only receive it. That's what the Bible teaches. Don't try to bring a gift and hope for a perhaps situation. Receive the gift. God's gift of his Son. Receive it and be reconciled. That is the only certain way to face God as friend. And he's given it. Take it. If you haven't, why not today? Why not right now? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, if there's anyone in this room that doesn't realize that they have waged war against you, I hope that they would just sense it right now. No one has lived up to your standard, and that means that everyone justly deserves your wrath. But because you love, you've made a way for reconciliation. We don't have to bring the gifts. We don't have to send them. You sent it. It's Jesus. I pray that we would all believe in that, either be renewed in our faith and our confidence that you have made a way for us to receive it and not achieve it. And if there's anyone this morning that just doesn't know this, I pray that right now, through the power of the Holy Spirit, they'd be changed. They would no longer try to appease you, but just receive you through Jesus by recognizing that they are a sinner in need of a Savior. And that is only through God's only Son, the world's only Savior, Jesus Christ. We pray these things in your name. Amen. Well, friends, as we normally do, I'm not going to dismiss you. I'm going to send you out. And if any of you are reconciled to God, you have been called into a ministry of reconciliation. This passage is actually my salvation passage when I was 18 years old in high school. And so I'm going to read this to you and send you out. Would you stand with me as I read from 2 Corinthians 5:17? Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Friends, go in peace, go reconciled, go to be a reconciler. You're sent. Amen.